Well, I'm interviewing Professor Murray Pittock, who this morning gave an absolutely fascinating lecture on the Jacobites in 18th century Scotland. Unfortunately, I had to miss half of it to do another of these interviews, which I bitterly regret. So the first thing I wanted to ask you, Murray, is whether you have published books on this period.
Yes, I've written quite a number of books on the subject. I think the two I pick out are The Myth of the Jacobite Clans, which enjoyed its most recent edition about 2009, of course came out 20 years ago, which argues for the conventionality of the Jacobite army in 1745 and its conventional organisation and its conventional arming. And I think one of the things very pleasing is that the archaeological evidence has now matched up with the archival evidence to show just how many guns the Jacobite army had, and how in fact swords were really the weapon of the officer class, really, as they were in the British army. So that's the first. I'd also pick out Material, Culture and Sedition, which was published 2 years ago, which looks at how objects, rituals, the use of Latin, glass, textiles and so on were means of communicating Jacobite sympathies. And I'm about to bring out Culloden, the Battle in History, Historiography and Memory for Oxford University Press, which just is a new military history of Culloden, but also the what Culloden has meant culturally in the British Isles in the 275 years since it was fought.
Are you very familiar personally with the history of Traquair House?
I'm reasonably familiar with it, yes, and I use quite a lot of examples from Traquair in Material, Culture and Sedition particularly.
Is it a typical Jacobite house in Scotland?
It's an excellent survival. Quite a lot of them actually were seriously redecorated in the 19th century, and I think the late 18th, and quite a number of cases. Castle Fraser's possibly one. A lot of the previous plaster work and decor was washed out. The walls were cleared and whitewashed, so that actually this is a really good surviving example. We're pretty sure that there's some it stands with the House of Dun probably as one of the two best surviving examples of a Jacobite house.
Have you had a look? Have you had a chance to have a look at the priests' vestments upstairs and the way in which they were disguised to look like ordinary linen? Is that also yes. Typical of this period and this sort of house, this sort of family?
Well, it's typical of Catholic Jacobite families, but I mean it's the best survival in Scotland I'm aware of. But again, there aren't most Jacobite family houses, the House of Dun, Castle Fraser, so on. They are Episcopalian houses.
Oh, really?
With some Presbyterians, in fact, but not Catholic. There are relatively few great Catholic houses, and some of them, for example, at Kirkconnell, would have been changed out of all recognition since the mid-18th century.
There were penalties, I imagine, on Jacobite Catholic families. Did that persuade some of them to, or coerce some of them into changing religion? And was it how possible was it for a family that wanted to remain recusant to survive during those centuries?
Well, I mean, there were serious penalties. The question is, as with the penal laws in Ireland, how much they were enforced. It's probably easier to be a Catholic if you're the Earl of Traquair than it is to be a Catholic if you're... it's certainly impossible to be a Catholic if you're a lawyer in Edinburgh, because you can't be a lawyer. because local gentry families, quite often, and noble families, they have a lot of deference and consent round them. People agree not to kind of raid them too often, to look at if mass is being said, that kind of thing. Or indeed, as sometimes happens in the north of England, you know, the local magistrate goes hunting with them and just, you know, doesn't really want to cause a fuss, and they keep a good table and all that kind of thing. So it is possible. We don't know the extent to which some Catholics conform to Episcopalianism in Scotland. One of the interesting things is that when the British government came down, Episcopalians very heavily after 1745, there are quite a number of reports of Episcopalians moving to go to Mass. But there isn't any systematic examination of the issue. Have I answered the question?
You have, yes. I happen to be a Catholic, but I'm also interested in the degree to which... I noticed that you've also written extensively on Ireland.
Yes.
And my family are Irish. Yes. And I was wondering whether in Scotland there were similar practices. So, for example, I think in some cases you could have the eldest son in each family conform while secretly remaining a Catholic, and you could move that down a number of generations so as to avoid the kind of depredations that the penalties for entailed, and the shrinking of an estate. I believe this estate is quite a lot smaller than it was, say, in the 17th century.
Yes, indeed, the family did suffer quite extensively for sticking to the Catholic religion throughout, but they didn't. There weren't quite the same penalties here as under the Irish penal laws, because there wasn't, as it were, an incoming land-hungry class who wanted hold of Catholic land and caused that to drop to about 5% of Irish land owned by Catholics about the 18th century, by the end of the 18th century. So it was a bit easier, but at the same time, it was challenging, and anyone who held firm to Catholicism could expect their estate to be eroded very clearly over time. There's a big contrast, for example, with Arniston, where the Dundas estate now is exactly the same size to the acre, more or less, as it was in 1730.
But did you get any of this similar practice of having the eldest son conform again down through various generations?
No, the families tended to be loyal to Catholicism.
So do you think that represents a different characteristic in the Irish temperament and the Scottish temperament?
I think it represents the risk is manageable. It is possible to inherit, whereas in the Irish case it isn't. You have lost the estate.
And tell me what Beyond Borders mean. I think this is your first visit.
It is indeed.
What value you find in an exercise like Beyond Borders?
Well, the event. I mean, I think it's a splendid event, very imaginative. And I think one of the great things that's happened here at Tracare is that the family have used the position, the house, and the history in a really imaginative way, and that, frankly, does not happen with all ancient families in great houses. But one of the things I wasn't aware of before I came was the extent, the international footprint, and the extent of the UN connection. And I've had some very interesting conversations since I arrived, because one of the things I work on in a wider context is the formation of cultural and national identities. And one of the key issues for me is the term state, and the idea of what underpins statehood is an inherited discourse from the 19th century, but it still permeates the thinking of a lot of international organizations and think tanks. And actually, it is absolute state sovereignty at every level, from mass migrants to the ability to realistically project power in the world, is frankly not there in the same sense it was in 1850, but we still think in terms of in state recognition and formation in those terms. I think Beyond Borders is very interesting precisely because it has a relevance to those questions, not to say the rise of alternative states like Islamic State.
Nowhere, I think, will you find that more strongly represented than at the UN. You only need to read the UN Charter. Mm-hmm. It starts off, the preamble talks about we the people, but it's very clear in the rest of the charter that the people are represented by states.
Yes.
And when I was at the UN, there was a very considerable resistance to allowing NGOs even to come in and observe meetings, because the delegates felt that they were representing the states, and that was their business, and nobody else's. We in the Secretariat were more welcoming, but we very often encountered difficulties, because particularly those states which were more authoritarian and centralized were the most resistant of all to allowing in non-governmental representatives.
And yet for so many people within states have got an increasing attraction towards single issue politics which cuts across the state in precisely that way.
Yeah.
It's only one example of the way in which the counter currents are not always thought through.
Alas, I'm not sure that we're ever going to get an extensive revision of the UN Charter to bring it up to date. And one of the things that, that strikes me, I have to say, is the that the kind of the vision and the stamina and the willingness to educate public opinion that was the mark of earlier eras seems to have gone, and that modern politics, because of their velocity and intensive media coverage, have to produce results very quickly. So taking 3 months, or whatever it was, 4 months in 1945 in San Francisco doesn't seem very plausible today.
No, I think that's absolutely right. But I mean, and I'm sure you're right about the way the UN structures its thinking. But one of the things that continues to have an effect in is the UN's role in state formation and state development, and that is, I think, an issue because the creation of new states on such an old palimpsest has consequences which can be unanticipated.
Makes more work for us for soft mediation and also for groups like Beyond Borders. Thank you very much for which I thought was the most fascinating lecture of the weekend so far, even if I was unfortunately had to miss half of it.
Well, thank you. Very, very good. Pleasure to meet you, Sir Kieran.
Good. Thanks a lot.